Welcome to our August 2nd worship service at Grace Lutheran Church, downtown Green Bay. It is the ninth Sunday after Pentecost for those who are taking sermon notes. We're glad you are able to be with us this morning and hope you are blessed by our time together. Our service continues to be recorded for YouTube, Facebook, and our website. If you know someone who is looking to participate in worship via radio, please let them know about our Sunday morning 8 a.m. broadcast at 1400 a.m. WDUZ. The most recent newsletter contained opportunities to serve here at Grace. Please refer to it, and if you would like further information or are able to assist with some of the ministry opportunities listed in the newsletter, please contact the church office. Communication continues to be very important. If your email or phone number has changed, please call or email us. Our office is staffed weekdays from 8 a.m. until 4:30 p.m. Pastors can be reached either at church or at our home. Our home phone number can be found in the newsletter. We are grateful to the members and friends of Grace who continue to support as well as staff our food pantry. A reminder that our food pantry hours are Tuesdays from 1 until 3 in the afternoon, and Fridays from 9 until 11 in the morning. And this morning we thank Rose Schumacher for being with us. She is our musician for today. We begin our worship with the prelude. Our service continues with the confession and forgiveness. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, whose steadfast love is everlasting, whose faithfulness endures from generation to generation. Amen. Trusting in the mercy of God, let us confess our sin. Reconciling God, we confess that we do not trust your abundance, and we deny your presence in our lives. We place our hope in ourselves and rely on our own efforts. We fail to believe that you provide enough for all. We abuse your good creation for our own benefit. We fear difference and do not welcome others as you have welcomed us. We sin in thought, word, and deed. By your grace, forgive us. Through your love, renew us. And in your Spirit, lead us, so we may live and serve you in newness of life. Amen. Beloved of God, by the radical abundance of divine mercy, we have peace with God through Christ Jesus, through whom we have obtained grace upon grace. Our sins are forgiven. Let us live now in hope. For hope does not disappoint, because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Let us pray. Glorious God, your generosity waters the world with goodness, and you cover creation with abundance. Awaken in us a hunger for the food that satisfies both body and spirit, and with this food fill all the starving world, through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
In the first reading for the ninth Sunday after Pentecost, God invites Israel to a great feast at which both food and drink are free. God also promises to make an everlasting covenant with all peoples, with promises that previously had been limited to Israel. As David was a witness to the nations, these nations shall now acknowledge the ways in which God has glorified Israel. The reading is from the 55th chapter of Isaiah. Ho, everyone who thirsts, come to the waters. And you that have no money, come buy and eat. Come, buy wine and milk without money and without price. Why do you spend your money for that which is not bread, and your labor for that which does not satisfy? Listen carefully to me, and eat what is good, and delight yourselves in rich food. Incline your ear, come to me, listen, so that you may live. I will make with you an everlasting covenant, my steadfast, sure love for David. See, I have made him a witness to the peoples, a leader and commander for the peoples. See, you shall call nations that you do not know, and nations that do not know you shall run to you because of the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, for he has glorified you. Word of God, word of life. Thanks be to God. The psalm for today is Psalm 145. The Lord is gracious and full of compassion, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love. Lord, you are good to all, and your compassion is over all your works. The Lord upholds all those who fall and lifts up those who are bowed down. The eyes of all wait upon you, O Lord, and you give them their food in due season. You open wide your hand and satisfy the desire of every living thing. You are righteous in all your ways and loving in all your works. You are near to all who call upon you, to all who call upon you faithfully. You fulfill the desire of those who fear you. You hear their cry and save them. You watch over all those who love you, but all the wicked you shall destroy. My mouth shall speak the praise of the Lord. Let all flesh bless God's holy name forever and ever.
Bye.
Reading begins a new section in Paul's letter, in which he will deal with the place of Israel in God's saving plan. He opens by highlighting how Israel's heritage and legacy include being God's children, having God's covenants, being given God's law, participating in worship of God, and receiving divine promises. The reading is from the 9th chapter of Paul's letter to the Romans. I am speaking the truth in Christ. I am not lying. My conscience confirms it by the Holy Spirit. I have great sorrow and unceasing anguish in my heart, for I could wish that I myself were accursed and cut off from Christ for the sake of my own people, my kindred according to the flesh. They are Israelites, and to them belong the adoption, the glory, the covenants, the giving of the law, the worship, and the promises. To them belong the patriarchs, and from them, according to the flesh, comes the Messiah, who is over all, God blessed forever. Amen. Word of God, word of life. Thanks be to God.
Holy Gospel according to Matthew, the 14th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. Now when Jesus heard about the beheading of John the Baptist, he withdrew from there in a boat to a deserted place by himself. But when the crowds heard it, they followed him on foot from the towns. When Jesus went ashore, he saw a great crowd, and he had compassion for them and cured their sick. When it was evening, the disciples came to him and said, "This is a deserted place, and the hour is now late. Send the crowds away so that they may go into the villages and buy food for themselves." Jesus said to them, "They need not go away. You give them something to eat." They replied, "We have nothing here but 5 loaves and 2 fish. And Jesus said, "Bring them here to me." Then he ordered the crowds to sit down on the grass. Taking the 5 loaves and the 2 fish, he looked up to heaven and blessed and broke the loaves and gave them to the disciples, and the disciples gave them to the crowds. And all ate and were filled, and they took up what was left over of the broken pieces, 12 baskets full. And those who ate were about 5,000 men, besides women and children. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Without moving your hands, look at them right now. What are they doing? Is your hand holding a glass of juice or a cup of coffee? Is your hand just lying there on your lap? Is your hand covering a yawn? Or maybe moving the volume switch on your radio or computer? What are your hands doing right now? And what do your hands do during the day? Hands hold things like a cup, a fork, or a spoon. Hands push things open, like a door. Hands can hold a pencil or pen or type on a keyboard. Hands can pick someone up when they have fallen down. Hands wave a greeting to other people. Hands are pretty incredible parts of the human body, aren't they? They can be used in so many different ways. Hands can be used in ways that bring help and show love. Hands can also be used in ways that bring harm. A hand curled like a fist, if used violently against someone else, can cause great pain. A hand can be used to grab things from other people, like pulling a toy away from someone else. A hand can be used to hold on tightly to things so that we don't have to share with others. A hand that is curled and held tight can't be used to help someone else. In the psalm for today, the writer says, "You, O God, open wide your hand and satisfy the desire of every living thing." A hand that is held open can reach out and be a sign of help and welcome to someone else. A hand that is held open is how we are able to share things from one person to another. A hand that is open says, "I care." The psalmist reminds us that God's hand is wide open. We have been given a wonderful planet in which to live, and we have been given love not just from our family and friends, but from our God. The psalmist reminds us that God's hand is wide open and we are welcomed. We are loved and cared for by our God. In the gospel reading for today, we see Jesus opening his hands and bringing food and healing and love to others. That is our God at work with hands wide open. And when we use our hands in acts of love, care, and service toward other people, when we share what we have been given with others, then our hands are used by God to be a blessing. Hands wide open, hands that show love. Just last year, these summer months included for many of us weekly treks to the local farmers markets. Remember the bustling crowds and the many vendors all selling their different products? Some tables would be overflowing with vegetables. Others would hold fresh-cut flowers. Numerous food trucks, each dispensing their own particular ethnic food choice, would also be present. And then other stalls would house vendors who sold wood crafts, homemade soaps, and the list went on and on. Well, 21st century summer farmers markets are a remnant of the way things used to be, especially in ancient times, where marketplaces existed with individual vendors, each selling their particular wares, lining the streets or squares of villages and towns, so that people could shop each day for what they needed for that day's meal. Such ancient marketplaces were the primary locations for the buying and selling of food and other items needed for daily life. Today's lesson from Isaiah begins with a vendor's greeting, an attempt to get the shopper's attention. Ho! Come to the waters! Come! Buy wine and milk and bread. In ancient times, finding all of those valuable, necessary commodities in the same place and at the same time was pretty much impossible. You couldn't get that assortment of items from just one vendor. You would have to shop from stall to stall and maybe even travel to other marketplace locations to find wine and milk and bread. And furthermore, what you could buy on any given day changed depending upon what the vendors had brought to sell. Your intent may have been to purchase cucumbers, but if the cucumber vendor wasn't present, you'd simply have to substitute or go without. Long before refrigeration, logistics and supply chain management, weather or political events way beyond an individual's influence or control could determine if the ancient marketplace vendors had anything to sell at all, and if what they offered was what you were looking for. Sounds a little like shopping during a pandemic, doesn't it? In this passage, the writer of Isaiah describes not only having the necessities of life available, but to have all of them present and available at the very same time. The writer then goes on to describe a veritable feast where people can delight in rich food. And not only are people invited to eat well, but the feast is being given free of charge. No one is left out because of their economic condition. This description of this lavish meal would have had special appeal to those who lived in exile, the people to whom Isaiah spoke. The message being, God has not abandoned you despite the oppressive situation in which you find yourselves, living in a foreign country, adapting to a new culture, trying to figure out if there is a place for you within that society to survive both socially and economically. God has not abandoned you, says Isaiah. The message to those in exile was that God wants you to have all that you need, all that causes you delight. But then, the author challenges the people and asks, but what is really valuable? What is the source of your delight? Is it that special cheese you like to eat, or a particular vintage of wine you like to drink? Is the meaning of life to just satisfy your needs and wants? Does the labor, pursuit, and the attainment of those types of experiences really satisfy your inmost being? What is really valuable? The author then answers his own question. What is really valuable? It is the promise made by God to God's people. It is the promise of an everlasting covenant. And this promise of God to never forget us or abandon us is what people of God stake their lives on. No matter where we live or the circumstances of our lives, citizen or refugee, impoverished or wealthy, the message is the same. God will not forget us or abandon us. What is truly valuable? Living our lives, trusting in God's abundant love. The gospel reading for today shows us what God's abundant love looks like. Jesus, Son of God, looks out upon the crowds and has compassion for them. Jesus has compassion for the sick, for the hungry, for the children, for the outcasts, all those marginal, barely eking out an existence people. Jesus lovingly looks out at the crowd, and then Jesus looks up to heaven. And the power of God, the abundance of God, is shared in the meal that not only feeds the stomach, but with the message that gives life. God has not forgotten you or abandoned you. The lavish meal promised in Isaiah is shared as Jesus breaks bread and feeds the crowd. And there is enough for everyone. Why? Because God works miracles. And there are two miracles in this gospel story. There is, of course, Jesus, who with very little to work with, 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish, feeds a crowd of people. But the other miracle in this story is that there were followers of Jesus within that crowd who shared what they had. The loaves and the fish weren't conjured up by Jesus from midair. They came from the hearts, hands, and labors of Jesus' followers. Followers of Jesus trusting in the abundant love and providence of God shared what they had been given, hands wide open. God has created a world in which there is enough for everyone. There is still enough for everyone. And yet, 821 million people, 1 in 9 children of God, living on God's abundant earth, go to bed hungry at night. And now, with the pandemic continuing to take an even growing toll on the most vulnerable, more and more folks are still facing hunger. There is abundance in the economic systems of the world. In the gifts of creation, there is abundance enough to feed and clothe and care for all of God's people. But there is also an abundance of human sin. In the gospel story, we celebrate the actions of those people who brought forth the 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish. However, humans being who they are, there was most likely additional food among the people in the crowd to whom Jesus ministered. Food being kept out of sight, people focused on what they lacked and not upon the abundance they possessed. And what was Jesus' response to that crowd? He fed everyone. No questions asked. No needs testing required. No heart discerned. That is divine, abundant love. And it was poured out upon everyone. And by the grace of God, it is poured out upon you and me. May we be inspired by the abundant life we have received to share, to serve, and to live our lives in ways that demonstrate that what we really value is what God believes is valuable. Amen.
Jesus, shine, feel peace, light, peace. shining in the midst of the darkness, shining Jesus, light of the world, shine upon us.
Service continues as we confess our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Confident of your care and helped by the Holy Spirit, we pray for the church, the world, and all who are in need. You take resources that appear to be meager, bless them, and there is enough. May your church trust that what you bless and ask us to share with the world is abundantly sufficient. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Your bountiful creation offers sustenance and life for all creatures. Protect this abundance for the well-being of all. Reverse the damage we have caused your creation. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. You offer yourself to all the nations and peoples of the earth, inviting everyone to abundant life. Bring the prophetic vision to fullness, that all nations will run to you and that nations who do not know you will find their joy in you. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. You open your hand and satisfy the desire of every living thing. Hear the anguish of tender hearts who cry to you in suffering and satisfy their deepest needs. Bring wholeness and healing to those who suffer in body, heart, soul, and mind, especially those we name now in our hearts or aloud at this time. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. You offer freely the fullness of salvation. Give our congregation such a welcoming heart that our words and actions may extend your free and abundant hospitality to all whom we encounter. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. You gather your saints as one, united in the body of Jesus. Bring us with all your saints to the heavenly banquet. We remember with love and thanksgiving the saints we have known. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. In certain hope that nothing can separate us from your love, we offer these prayers to you through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Pleasant to repeat.
May the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord's face shine on you with grace and mercy. Lord, look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen.